Well, I'm sure you can guess what we're going to talk about. But before we do, a quick reminder of what happened yesterday evening in Ottawa. Catherine Cullen highlighted it this way last night.
The man in the front is the Conservative whip. He can't get by a group of NDP MPs, including leader Tom Mulcair. On the left, the Prime Minister comes striding over to intervene. He has words with Mulcair. At the same time, he clearly also makes contact with MP Ruth Ellen Brosseau. Trudeau walks away. You can see Brosseau angrily telling her colleagues what transpired. As Brosseau leaves, Trudeau comes back. Mulcair is enraged. Trudeau appears to be headed after Brosseau. He comes back, and Mulcair and Trudeau shout.
Quite something. And that led to three apologies from the Prime Minister last night and a whole bunch more today. Here's what that looked like.
Mr. Speaker, I would like to take a moment to apologize. I apologize to the member. I would like to apologize directly to the member. I apologize unreservedly. I apologize to my colleagues. I made a mistake. It was my mistake. I made a mistake, and I am apologizing.
All right, then. Andrew and Chantel are here, and so is Shachi Curl, Executive Director of the Angus Reid Institute. So, was this a big deal or was it not a big deal?
It's potentially. I don't think in and of itself, I don't think any sensible person thinks the Prime Minister ran amok and tried to attack people. But it was odd behavior, and odd in ways that came at a very bad time for the government. There's been a growing sense, I think, that this government is not what it appears, or not what it makes it out to be, itself out to be. It is open, transparent, more democratic, different than the others, et cetera. And we've had a series of things, whether it's cutting off debate on parliamentary bills, whether it's rejecting opposition amendments in committee, whether it's the total mishandling of the electoral reform bill, whether it's this latest thing, this government motion to essentially commandeer the workings of parliament. They've looked both arrogant and at times erratic and incompetent. But it didn't matter so much because you had the smiling face of the Prime Minister walking around in his shirt sleeves being everybody's boyfriend. It kind of kept a lid on it. If the Prime Minister himself starts looking both high-handed and somewhat erratic in his behavior, and it's very hard to explain his conduct here, then that not only tarnishes his brand, but it starts to maybe cause people to look a little more closely at the government itself.
Chantal.
It was unbecoming behavior on the part not just of a prime minister, but a parliamentarian. If he'd been the House leader or someone with a position like that, the opposition today would rightly have called on his party to suspend him from those functions. Because in all the years that I've covered parliament and you two, I've never seen a prime minister do something like this. And in any setting, to physically go to drag someone in the way that this happened would not be acceptable. It derails the government's agenda, so it is bad for the government. At this point, there is no certainty that it can achieve their legislative goals anymore. It's going to make it, I would predict, harder for them to deal with the Senate because there's kind of a resonance between the two houses. The more you arm twist the opposition and the House of Commons, the more the Senate feels legitimate in meddling with government legislation. But I think it also did what Andrew explained. These things usually happen in the bubble. We care about them because we cover them. But in the outside world, they're not considered big deals. They're inside baseball. It takes a long time for them to resonate outside. This is like taking a knife to the bubble and exposing it. It's impossible now to ignore that all is not run as it should be or as Justin Trudeau promised in the House of Commons.
Shachi, you're nodding your head in agreement there on some of those points?
After at least a dozen apologies, 24 hours later, there is an element among some House watchers saying, well, show's over, nothing to see here, move along. I don't think we know the answer to that yet. And a lot of that has to do with just the internet generation and the age that we're in. This is going to be shared socially over and over again with mashups and memes. And this is especially significant because when you look at the base that was so instrumental in electing Justin Trudeau, young voters, first-time voters, they're not being exposed to and necessarily hearing about what happened on shows like this. They're seeing it on their Facebook feeds, in their Reddits, on Twitter, and they're not necessarily seeing it with that apology or with the context around it or the what does it all really mean. For them, this is a situation that goes one of two ways. Either they say, well, the guy had a bad day, we all have bad days at work, he had a bad day, move on, it's sunny ways all over again, or it's he's just like every other politician. And this is not the person that I was expecting to see.
There's already been a consequence beyond the impact on his image, which is they've had to withdraw that government motion that
right.
I referred to.
So yeah. that, and they mean, that, you know, as a consequence, that the assisted death bill may
we'll
never
the
get
deadline.
There.
We shall see.
We'll
miss the deadline. Yes. We shall see. So not only have they lost a procedural tool, but they've been blooded. They look weak. They don't have the momentum. They don't have that effortless wind at their sails that they had. And that has to give aid and encouragement to the opposition who have been fighting this. Now, the only thing I would say as a caveat to this is the opposition themselves so mishandled this affair by their over-the-top reactions to it that they may not get as much bang for the buck because they've made themselves the issue more than the government.
All right. Let me show you some of that that reaction, because that's the other part of this last 24 hours. You know, if the prime minister was over the top, and he says he was the opposition over the top in some of these comments you'll watch here?
We had the Prime Minister, the Right Honourable Prime Minister, step into a group of opposition MPs, push aside members of the NDP opposition, and manhandle.
I witnessed as he strode across the floor with anger fierce in his eyes and face.
One wants to exaggerate the situation and to make this into something that it wasn't, to make this reminiscent of a dive in the 2006 World Cup. Perhaps we can go on.
He knocked one of my colleagues into the desk, physically Ladies. Shoved into the desk. I witnessed this.
And here what took place in this house was physical violence. In fact, you know, we know, and outside, people would call what happened here assault.
The offender never intended to hurt somebody. A drunk driver never intends to kill people.
That last one was quite something. What did you make of it all?
Okay, let's get serious here. The Prime Minister did not set out to push a female member of the House of Commons against the benches. That was clearly involuntary. It was an accident. Actually, last night, a lot of it focused on it. And I thought the dashing for the whip of the other party and dragging him was the serious offense. What happens then is all part of this mess, but I would think assault would be if you're actually going for that person with intent, and I didn't see any intent on the part of the Prime Minister. I think the opposition won everything it needed to win with this, and like every good thing, it should let the rest percolate in people's minds rather than continue.
It will be interesting to see. I get your point, Shachi, about social media and how it's changed everything. And I get Chantel's point that she hasn't seen anything like this happen in the House before, nor have I. Outside of the House, we all remember, you know, Jean Chrétien and his throttling of the protester in a park. That worked in a reverse way. We, you know, a lot of people thought, oh, he's going to pay the price for that. You know, prime ministers don't go around throttling protesters. And yet it went the other way for him. He gained a lot of public support because of the action he took. So, you know, you're in the research business. I mean, I'm not going to ask you to predict what your data will show, but is there, you know, is it obvious what the data will show here?
The difference between the Shawinigan handshake with Mr. Chrétien and what's happened here is one of expectations with Canadians and voters. In the case of what happened on Flag Day, that was very much in keeping with the persona that Canadians expected of Jean Chrétien. He was the scrapper, le petit gars, the guy who got into pool hall brawls. And here someone was coming at him and he shoved him aside. That was seen as a different situation than somebody who has come into Ottawa and said, I am going to be the lead on decorum in the House. I am going to make this place more polite and less threatening, and I am going to be the standard bearer on this. And all of a sudden we see behavior that I would suggest is not exactly in keeping with that expectation.
Yeah, he is the guy across the aisle 2 weeks ago to hug Ron and Ambrose on Fort McMurray.
But it matters who you do it to.
Sure.
It's one thing to and I don't think that that was becoming behavior on the part of Jean Chrétien, what happened there. But it is not the same to go after a fellow parliamentarian on the floor of the House of Commons.
I might put another way, which is Chrétien's behavior, I think, to many people was understandable. There had been a breakdown in his RCMP details. Some guy lunges at you. We might all react that way. Trudeau's behavior is inexplicable. It's very hard to understand. Either he'd just gotten way too accustomed to thinking of himself as being the boss and being in charge, and if there was a problem in Parliament, somehow that was his responsibility to go and sort it out like a teacher with a bunch of, you know, kids on the front steps of the high school smoking, and he needs to clear the path kind of thing. And or it was, you know, back to the kind of erratic behavior we used to see from him two or three years ago before his handlers kind of cleaned up his act. And neither of those is particularly going to be good for people's sense of who he is and his judgment. It's only one incident, and I don't want to make more of it than that. But to the extent that people are paying attention to that, it does look very odd.
Does it change the way this government now operates? I mean, you know, after all the, you know, the honeymoon remarks and all that aside, 6-7 months down the road, does this become day one of a new way of looking at this government?
It has shifted the benefit of the doubt over to the side of the opposition, and the government's dealing with the opposition at a time when the government actually needed a lot of benefit of the doubt to get its legislation through. Now, before we got to this last night, there's been this electoral reform process that has gotten off on the worst kind of footing for the government to advance its projects. The bill on assisted death is in trouble, maybe not in votes, but certainly in timing in both houses of parliament. And the session is coming to an end. So there are looming questions about the government's management of the House. And those times when you need to say, I'm the government and I need to get my agenda through, they are now hampered by this incident because they look like the bullies, as opposed to people who are trying to do good while the opposition is trying to block them.
And you can look like bullies if you look competent, but if you also look amateurish. I mean, we had that business with the vote on C-10 on the Air Canada bill where they nearly lost the vote by some process. There's this enormous overreaction, or so it appeared the next day, with this draconian motion to sort of take control of the House process. It just looks kind of erratic to begin with. So it's been a bad week even before this event. And as I say, I think that may make it to resonate more than it might have otherwise.
Shachin.
It's hard to unsee this type of thing. And so much of the emotional connection that Canadians have felt to Justin Trudeau and to this government have been on style points of his graceful choreography, a figure skater out there on the ice. Well, this looks more like a blue line grinder who's already got 2 minutes in the box and is facing a game misconduct. And so, you know, it's difficult to unsee it. And, you know, we don't necessarily want to overstate things. If there is a sunny lining in all of this, it's the fact that it's happening at a time where he's still enjoying very high approval ratings, as is government. There is a political cost to this. We don't know how big it will be, but there is also political capital to spend.
We should say that he was right to apologize as fully as he did. They were right to withdraw that government motion. In both cases, I think they took some of the steam out of this, so they've reacted well since the event. So we'll see.
And a word of caution to the opposition, there is not going to be a lot of public opinion appetite out there to have this drawn out for months on end. At some point, it becomes smaller the more you try to make it big. The Liberals are lucky. This comes on the eve of a break, and in a month, a summer break. So unless they really go out of their way to make trouble, the price that they paid has been largely paid, I think.
All right. We're going to leave it at that for tonight. Good to see you all in here. Shachin, good to have you join us again from Vancouver.